But we'll see. It is good. It's just you get to a point, snowball, BKB on SF, jug spin, your hero's now worthless, and their damage output drops significantly.
All right, you've heard from our illustrious analysts. Now to hear from the casters, we've got Durka and Blitz.
Thanks, lads. That's right, OG against MVP. Blitz, taking a look at these drafts, I've got to say, MVP in their comfort zone for this patch, definitely, but I agree fully. This looks like a Frankfurt Major draft from OG. Dazzle, Tusk, the two saving supports. Shadowfiend mid for Miracle. When was the last time we saw SF mid, man?
It has been a really long time. Like, this hero just does not work like it used to. But I think OG is saying, like Swindle said, let's just kind of bring it back to our roots. We saw Miracle primarily play the carry position. I think almost exclusively at the Shanghai Major. And this time around, I think kind of retooled, said this is the kind of change that we need. Maybe that this hero can still work for OG. And I mean, if anybody can do it, it's definitely going to be Miracle.
So straight off the bat, early warding out from OG. Relatively aggressive ones, you know, one towards the offlane, giving Moon Meander maybe a little more room to breathe and maneuver up there and not get sideswiped by that lion. But Forev's offlane on this Batrider, how do you think he's going to be able to really cope with this lane, and what are you aiming to accomplish?
I think you just try to get the stack off, and MVP, that's why they're at the bottom side of the map right now, to protect the camp so that he can go for the pulls if he wants as well. And try to keep both supports there if you can, and at top, Q is going to get gone on and barely going to get away, but
he
still.
He pinches that rune straight under their noses. Yes. Q, oh, sneaky little devil already off to a great start. So, Miracle, not getting that experience or gold, but did he deward? He's on 50 yeah. XP, yeah.
He also got a soul out of that. It kind of just helped out a little bit. Makes the lane somewhat okay for him, but one of the few times we're going to see QO and MP actually switch up, because MP is their invoker player most of the time.
It's something that I've been co-casting a lot with. Oh, actually, we'll wait a second for this one. Top lane, Moon Meander. This is the wrap-in from Febby.
Oh, out of mana.
Dubu. For QO, he's actually getting burned down by the Iron Shop. The tower aggro straight onto Moon. And this might be your first play. He tries to threaten the Iron Shop, but he's gone. QO down to 20 HP. Close to death, but as always, cutting it tight. Febby, are you okay?
Ooh. This is pretty okay, though. He almost killed three different heroes at once, and yeah, Febby's immediately going to go for the suicide, but QO is in a pretty rough spot right now, and if Moon Meander just comes back up here, he can actually do a lot of damage. He went for the vacuum level 1 to try to get the kill, but 40 damage and 250 radius is almost nothing. That felt a little bit off to me. If he goes to the Surge, I think he has almost the same impact there.
No salves or anything up on this top lane, just relying on tangos the full way. And mid lane, still the dual lane between Fly, MP, and Miracle, of course. But yeah, back to things. March and Heen, I've been casting with them a fair bit for Southeast Asian Dota, and they were telling me we refused to pick QO Invoker a while back, because it was like 38% overall patches. This patch has been pretty good. They still do like to mix it up, but I think 70% was QO's Invoker win rate this patch, especially. But for now, Forev down a bottom lane, this Batrider, he did get the pull off initially, dragging it back and getting himself to level 2. And he's going to aim to, he can't get towards that stack fast enough, but he can just farm through with that sticky napalm and his nice little clarity.
Yeah, I think that's a bit of a mistake. I think this is a lane that is hard for him for sure, but Crit's already going to make the rotation, and this is something I really like, because Moon's already putting a lot of pressure in this lane. And maybe they think if they just add one hero to the mix, they could actually get a kill. And Crit's level 2 as well. And this is definitely a rotation that you won't see coming. They already know that they dewarded one of the wards in the mid lane. So this is a really decent maneuver by Crit, but unfortunately, it looks like he got spotted out. And MVP, they're going to make the move now on Moon Meander.
He's baiting.
Still doesn't have Surge.
QO half HP, and they're going to go in with the Ice Shards, but a good double impale back from Febby will save his mate. Allow MVP to disengage, but still, OG, they're looking for the snowball forward, and Dubu tries to roll, but it's not going to be enough. The Shadow Wave heal bomb, Dubu's gone, and Febby might be collateral damage. The Hex is not going to be enough. Febby will drop low. Another good Earth Spike, but Moon Meander's perfect positioning gets himself in front of the target and allows them to snag another kill.
As a support, that's so hard to run away from, the double Ion Shell, especially when the heroes are right on top of you. Moon's already got the boots. Really good rotation by Crit once again, and probably what made that even easier was just that Fly came in at such an awkward timing that MVP definitely didn't anticipate him coming in. Because normally you'll see him switch down to the bottom lane, but they know that they've given their safe laner enough of an advantage that Horeb doesn't feel comfortable going down there, and he knows that as a solo bat, he can't really contest that Jug's farm. So this kind of just has to happen. If anything, I'd like to see Dubu rotate a little bit more around the map, but it feels like he kind of has to be up here because the Lion and the Spectre aren't enough to deal with the Darkseer by themselves.
Just trying to secure that safe lane. So Juggernaut down here, no tail, he's leading the last hit board. 26 for 5. Like you said, no real contest from Forab. He's just stacking up this large camp offset from his lane. Is this bat going to be looking to actually get into this Radiant jungle as well? Because there's no one utilizing it right now. Fly is stacking for the SF.
So, but Forab right now, he's got 3 stacks, I believe, in that jungle. Still doing somewhat okay. Doesn't really have a lot of lane presence at bottom, and that's the biggest problem right now, is that OG don't have to devote any of their supports even to that bottom lane, and this is how they used to play, is that they would just focus on dominating each of their lanes, which they've done so far. They've given their Darkseer a really good start despite the fact that he was killed initially. He's gone 2 kills, picked up boots, almost has the Sol Ring completely available, and the lane doesn't get better. Like, Kyo's still gonna struggle against this. He doesn't have a lot of regen left over, not a whole lot of HP. Moon should get a decent amount out of this, and the mid lane is gonna be pretty good for Miracle, as he's got some stacks built up too.
And Dubu scouting out with this invis. I mean, OG, they saw him going across and they know he's around somewhere, but they've got the knowledge he's mid as he just punts Miracle across the lane. Get out of here. Try and give MP a little bit of an easier time as his phase boots are coming up shortly. We also saw QO pick up his. Now, this top lane, Swindles are saying the MVP have got to really focus on shutting down Moon Meander. But yeah, is this really possible when you've got 2 guys sitting behind him ready at a moment's notice just to get in there and stop the aggression?
Yeah, this is a really good move by OG because once again, they're free to roam around the map. The Juggernaut is, again, not being too contested at bottom. He's getting more or less free farm. Forev just doesn't have the hero anymore that can deal with the Jug who's level 6. And so you're not even going to send the Batrider down here. Instead, you're going to focus on this farm, but at top,
I thought he was going on the Spectre, but he wanted the Satyr. Crit gets himself a nice chunk of change there. And honestly, he's close to Arcane Boots. Crit, this Tusk, who's level 3.5, has been just roaming around looking for opportunities. Has a good amount of gold to his name. But I think MVP, they're not too afraid to kind of sit back on their laurels, you know, give Spectre time to hit that level 6, and maybe that's when they look to strike.
This is a 2v4 rune fight.
Oh my goodness, look at them all. OG shards barely catches MP in. The kick is not going to be on point. But then they've got the Ghost Walk and no reveal here from OG. So it looks like the Invoker should be okay.
Well, they burned through a lot of his mana, and he's not going to be able to pressure in this lane very much anymore.
Oh, there's the Haunt. They got level 6 on QO and Moon Meander. He drops again.
They absolutely needed that. For the Spectre alone, he really needed that just to be able to keep up. The Jug is getting more or less free farm. He needs to close that gap in some way. And Forever bottom, he's hit level 5. He's got the Trinkle Boots now too. I'd really like to see him hit 6 and maybe even gank Moon again. I feel like if he goes for mid, as soon as he hits 6, somebody from OG is going to be ready for that. But maybe if they can get the immediate burst damage in conjunction with the Lion, it's a little bit more unpredictable.
So with this SF, you know, we haven't seen it a while in competitive. Have you seen it at all in your pubs?
I have not seen it.
No,
forever.
So, kind of, you know, hypothesizing here, what kind of build can we expect from Miracle? Is it going to go back to like S and Y?
I think mech is kind of bad here just because you're against a Quaswex Invoker. Otherwise, I would have said it was okay. And I think S and Y is all right.
Because at some point, we saw the Midas invoke, sorry, the Midas Shadow Fiend, the Helm of the Dominator SF to take down Ancients and farm more efficiently across the neutrals. Oh, look at this snowball then. They've got the Omnislash as well. QO gets caught, but a brilliant Earth Spike from Febby saves him, and the dagger over the shards will get him out in this TP reaction from MVP. Thick and fast, just like they. Oh, yeah, catching the Juggernaut as well. He's got no spin, but he does slash through. QO barely gets himself away with a vacuum back. MP, again, an Earth Spike from Febby catches 2, and MVP, they're going to get out with their lives, not unscathed though. Everything so close to disaster for both teams.
Yeah, they're barely able to hold there. And that was a really good effort by MVP. Like, Febby played that fight perfectly. He played the range game, he made sure that he was going to get multiple Earth Spikes off. He was patient with it, pays off for them in the end. A 1-for-1 trade. The net worth advantage is now in a decent lead for the Spectre, and this is the worst thing that you want as OG, because you want to be the team that's constantly getting the map control with your 2 roaming supports. Especially since you devoted so much time to shutting down QO and the Batrider essentially wasn't even in the lane at bottom, but he's going to make his move on crit at bottom as here comes the haunt.
Yeah, it looks like a simple takedown, unless crit can get the snowball, but that turn rate from the stick in A4 makes it not impossible. What does that give 4F? 1,300 gold, 900 off that blink, 8.5 minutes in when we were looking at this, thinking he can't contest the jug, but he's kind of traded farm relatively well.
Yeah, and I really like the fact that he's going for these lassos that aren't super obvious. They were not prepared for that one at all.
Oh, up at top, Moon Meander. Caught with the EMP and the good chaining here. Combo through from MP. He's gonna surge himself over to the west, and is he gonna be able to get out of this?
No.
Moon Meander, are you kidding me? He's got the... No, he doesn't have a TP. He's gonna hide himself away in the trees. If he can stay here for much longer, he'll try and surge out, but I think at this point he knows he's dead. Just wasting time of MVP. He said he was going to give up being bad-mannered, but you try everything you can.
Yeah, I think that was a pretty good attempt, but he was pretty much blocked off. He didn't really have a lot of angles at that point, and the line was waiting for the other end. That's going to give Febby a really quick level 6, though. If you compare it to the other two supports on the side of OG, they're both level 4. This level 6 line can pretty much contest anywhere. Now I would like them to go for the smoke on mid, because they know that both the supports have used... their TPs, one for bottom, one for top, and you do have one on fly, but the burst damage potential is there with just the two supports alone. They could even get aggressive at bottom if they were really fast and maybe catch no-tail.
Well, 4F just gonna firefly away, and it looks like it will be the SNY for SF. He's got himself an ogre belt. Take a look at this though, 4F. So difficult to jump on him behind this tier one. They were trying, they were thinking of it, this observable though spotting out. Moon Meander's Darkseer, and if Febby can get in range, he's not in time. The kick will be off the mark as well, as Moon Meander just surges himself, hasting around. While on the side, 4F, Fairy Fire barely gives him up. He tried to turn for the lasso, but look at the silence onto No Tail. He's got nothing left to give. The two saving supports, Fly will try from the high ground to Crave, but doesn't have the rangers. MP jumped on by the two supports. The Spectral Horn, you're right, Blitz. Come straight back in. Fly and crit. Grave TP, something, anything, as Miracle comes in with the razors. Just pushing him back and making sure no one else will drop here, but man, that Spectre is so difficult to handle as such a fragile support as Fly's Dazzle.
Yeah, the complexity, you guys talked about it. MVP, OG, both these teams are looking to push the pace, and MVP have just been a lot more clean with their execution so far. And it's not like OG aren't trying. Like, they're trying to make moves around the map, and the first move top was incredibly successful, but ever since then, it's pretty much been all
look at
MVP.
That. Chained to perfection. Moon Meander, you can try all you want, but MP is going to get himself a killing spree. This Invoker, he's got a lot of money in the bank as well, as items are flowing freely for MVP.
Yeah, they still have two of the top net worths in the game on the side of OG, in the Shadow Fiend and the Jug, but that's kind of what you expected. Like, Spectre is a hero that if you're within 1-200 of the next highest net worth, you're in a fine position right now, and probably even more importantly than that, it's the support levels that you're getting. Ebby is going to be a monster in a game like this. He's just behind the Batrider when it comes to net worth. When it comes to levels, he's in a much better position than either hero on the side of OG, and he's even going to get a lot of this XP mid. Miracle's going to try to zone him out, but Ebby going to pull the creep wave up. I don't think this is a tower that you want to give up if you're MVP, especially against OG's lineup. You don't want them to establish tempo, and they're going to start rotating a lot of heroes in for this one.
We do not have the haunt, though. 25 seconds, a kick. Threads the eye of the needle there, but the tornado will actually clip the back end of Fly with Flame Break as well, but No Tail zones him out relatively effectively. MVP, they give up the tower.
Yeah, I think if they had the Spectre ultimate, that would have been 100% a fight they take, but unfortunately for them, it just isn't up yet. That was a good move by OG, though. That mid-tower push was a lot faster than MVP expected, and they didn't know that they were going to commit that hard for it. They're immediately going to go for the smoke now, try to play for this bottom area. MVP, they do have a lot of their core ultimates up. No finger yet, and the Earth Spirit doesn't have mana quite yet, either. This might be a really good attempt by them.
It's a little bit awkward timing here for MVP as well, because obviously 4F is farming for his blink. Dubu's there waiting, checking to make sure if he gets jumped on. There's always that safe potential. Do they have reveal though? If this Invoker goes into the Ghost Walk, he pops it in time and he's quick enough. They'll try and chase him through. But MP realizes that with no detection at all on OG, he's perfectly safe.
Yeah. And he thought about going for the TP, but he's like, I actually don't even have to risk this at all. Realizing there's just no sentries available, and that's just a little bit more time wasted. Is Kyo's now gonna kind of reset, get out of there, go probably to the top half of the map again, as he knows that OG committed a lot for that one.
One saving grace here for OG is that they basically have mech done for Moon Meander. In fact, after the creep camp, yeah, he's got it fully completed. So he's 3-4-0, and you kind of look at his laning phase and you think, well, Lion killed him off a bunch of times, they got these kills, these pickoffs, even with the supports there defending him. But every time he's died, he hasn't really lost that much gold. He's always picking up these small incremental bits and bobs of that mech, and now with it done, what does this give OG in the long run?
I think there's some downsides as to how he played his... Actually, for OG, I think it's okay, because he wanted to keep both supports up there, and he wanted a lot of attention on himself, and that's something that he accomplished, but MVP have made it their focus to essentially just shut down Moon, and they have not done that.
Horn is ready to jump with the lasso. 4 hours there with a blink of flight. The Dazzle, he's the main target. They've got him and taken him out. There's no grave or heal. A miracle burning through with that fire flight. A perfect tornado. They've got them all. OG crypt apart at the seams. With miracle actually getting fingered down by Febby. 4 going to chase that by crit, but it's just not enough damage. OG have got nothing left in the tank. With no mana or no tail, he cannot Omni Slash. And QO, are you sure about this? Of course he is. Diving tier 3s. He just wants to kill everyone.
1 second for the spin.
Oh, is he going to survive?
Yeah, he barely gets that one.
Radiant's middle tower is under attack.
Well, MVP, they take down 2. Burning through the SF souls and a tier 1 mid to their name.
Could have been even worse for them is the crazy part. As OG barely got out of there, No Tail barely gets a spin off in time, and
No-Tail,
he's immediately going to go for the TP deal.
Bounces! Oh, beautiful stuff from No Tail, and with the EMP tornado, not quite going to scrape through the Blade Fury. MVP. How much damage did that do to the Spectre? Let's have a quick look. He didn't lose that much gold, 270 or so, but just losing your life there, you know, limiting yourself, limiting the time on the map you have to farm, right?
Yeah, and most importantly, that just kind of puts you on tilt. There were so many different targets, and he's like, I'm trying to run to you, Invoker, and it just happened to hit all three on him. That's going to be really frustrating for QO. Really good move by No-Tail to just go for it.
He TPs in on half HP. You know, who else is going to do that? No-Tail only. Dubu, very far forward. Deep in Radiant territory, but there's no one here to stop him. It's the entirety of OG. They're up at top looking for the tier 1. And Forev, I'm not sure this is a battle you really want to pick.
No, and his team definitely isn't ready for it, and that's the most important thing about defending towers. It's not even about the heroes that you have, it's just simply being there. Like, participation is half the battle. You want to be set up in a position where you can contest back, and if MVP are going to defend the second tier 1, or the second tier 2, they've got to get here now. It doesn't matter if you have TPs, you want to have at least 3 heroes preemptively here, so then you can TP 2 heroes to filter in, but nobody even has a TP on the side of MVP.
Invoker.
Neither of the supports.
I think Invoker's the only one that does. They've got a bunch of smokes, and they're going to use one of them now, and QO, I guess, has the Spectral Haunt. Tier 2 at top, Glyph expended, and OG, they're already doing structural damage across to this. Forev, though, looks like he is the last bastion of hope, just able to zone him back and say, you know what, we will defend. Out from Dubu, poking and prodding.
They're trying to buy time for the Invoker to come in.
Oh, you're right. Ice Shards are thrown with the Horn out. Who are they going to target, though? Miracle, Requiem wound up, trying to take out the illusions and reduce that damage, but Dubu getting spun out by No-Tail. They've killed off the Earth Spirit, but it's Ebola out, and Febby hexes up the jug, but it's back on the end. QO looks for the kill on Miracle, but Grave through by Fly. Now MVP, they still have spells to throw. No-Tail, Omni Slash in 3. It's level 2 as well. He's hit that level 11 mark. It's just sticking on a target. That's the difficulty.
Can
you pick him up with
the snowball
crit? Perfect placement. And now the Earthspike, really? Febby catches them both with a finger of death. Brings down the Tusk. No-Tail is deep behind enemy lines, and he's going to have to spin and TP, spin and run, spin and hide. The tornado catches 2 with a Darkseer EMP'd, stunned and taken out. MVP have baited him deep and taken him down. Fly and Moon Meander both dropping low. And I don't think there's much left here for Miracle to do. He'll right click down and barely miss the raise on Febby. But it's MP picking up a double kill and Dubu taking out the third.
Febby has just been an absolute god so far for MVP. The amount of stuns that he's gotten out of the snowball completely kills all momentum OG built up in that fight. For a second, it looked like MVP was just going to get slaughtered in that fight. The Juggernaut had the ultimate ready for QO, but he gets the timing just perfectly, and it seems like the Invoker plus the Earth Spirit, there's a lot of synergy there. Every time the tornado kicks up, he's ready with the stone, gets multiple stuns and silences. But you kind of have to ignore that because of just how well Febby's playing right now. Like, this is a Ravage line if I've ever seen one.
Some super sick stuff, and on top of all of this, it's giving QO the space and maneuverability he needs to jump from multiple illusions during that spectral haunt and allow him to pick his targets. You know, you're watching Miracle and thinking, well, this SF, you're racking up souls and you're getting these Requiems out. But at what moment in these team fights are the Requiems actually, you know, vital? Are they making a massive impact?
I think he had to throw that one out, but the problem is, right, the biggest issue is that he still is dying in almost all of these major team fights. He's 0-2-2, you're not really feeling the impact of the hero, and unless things have changed, SF is still a hero that relies on having more net worth, just flat out more than the other team, because he is so squishy. It is pretty easy to kite him before he has a BKB. And OG, it just feels like they're a little bit off from winning these fights, and MVP managed to clean up. The good news for them is they still have decent net worth on two of their cores, and Moon Meander has completed the mech, and he's doing okay for himself. It's just, again, it comes down to the two supports on the side of OG. They're getting really far behind. Febby's already completed a Blink Dagger. He's got 800 gold. Dubu's already got his Arcane Boots. We've seen what Earth Spirit can do with just pretty much levels.
Oh man, now is QO in this position. He's got his, you know, small incremental items, the drums, urn, phase boots, everything's looking good, but the 2,000 gold in the bank, it kind of makes me wonder. Oh, they're going to jump in. Crit, where are you? You're going to save your teammates because Miracle's being dragged back into the back end of the fight. You're right, there's no grave or heal. Two of them will get caught with their pants down, and the rest of OG up on the high ground. It's a good strategical position, but the spin barely. Oh, getting him out of that sticky situation while Forev blinks forward aggressively. But with no lasso and no catch, the wall is dropped. Crit being chased out by QO. He's not giving up. We see the kick across. They've got the two with the Earth Spike down as well. No tail. Got to look for the Omni Slash onto QO. Guess who it bounces to? Onto 4M and back to the creeps. But the roll from Dubu will force back OG. There's nothing left to be had here.
MVP just protecting each other at all costs, making sure that they get out as a group. And with two dead on the side of OG, it looks like they want to go for this push. But with the wall down, might be a little bit difficult, as a little bit hesitant to cross that. So another successful fight. I think that's three in a row so far for MVP. And once again, the two supports doing so much in all of these engagements.
Febby is absolutely godlike on these Earth Spikes. Really, really great performance from him. But back to QO. Item decision, what do you reckon, Blitz?
I think you go for the Radiance. It's kind of the build that QO likes to go. Mm-hmm. I know that he likes it as kind of like a game finishing item. Like, I have my Radiance now, get out of my game. None of your supports are going to be able to survive.
You're done for. You got no chance now. I've got my Radiance. I was just thinking along the lines of, you know, against Juggernaut, Mantastar is pretty good. Diffuser Blade's decent against, you know, Dazzle, Darkseer. But I think that Radiance, if he's going to get it at a time like this, you know, 21 minutes in after all these smaller items as well, he's already sitting on 3,000. The thing is, MVP, they don't really have a great, you know, Roche-taking lineup per se. They can't just go in there and say, we've got Minus Armor, we've got Lifesteal, we'll just go and take Roshan. How do you think they go about this, or do they even need to?
I don't even think they're that reliant on Roshan as a team. They know that when it comes to late game, they've got such a sick lineup. The Batrider is always going to scale well. They've got a lot of disables, which pairs nicely. And most importantly, they've got Spec and Invoker, who scale incredibly well into the late game. And you've got an Invoker with the Midas who just continues to scale on levels. Forev is now keeping up too. He's got a Boar Staff. Whenever he decides to get a gem, he's going to deny a lot of the vision from OG. And now OG are in a position where they don't want to play by themselves anymore. Like, they want to make sure that they're at least like two heroes together at all times, because they don't want to just get caught out by the Spec Haunt, the Bat Ults. They don't have the best vision on their side of the jungle, so they've kind of been hemmed in here. And this has just been really well done from MVP. This is the luxury that winning three fights in a row affords you.
Yeah, I was just taking a quick look at the graphs, actually, and you're right, this could snowball so far out of control if someone like Miracle was to get jumped towards the mid lane. But look at who's behind him. He's going to get jumped anyway. The horn through, but Forev, he's just dragged him straight back into that finger from Febby. Even with the Dying Requiem slowing him down, doing that damage reduction, it's just not great for them. The Omni Slash onto Forev, but he'll scrape away with about 200 HP. No-Tail spins onto MP, but No-Tail's got no backup. There's nowhere to help him. Finally, Febby blinks forward. They'll catch No-Tail. That zoning wall maybe will give them some respite here to return to their tier 2.
And once again, Dubu single-handedly drags two heroes by himself to the top side of the map, doesn't even die. MVP manages to use that time to get out, get a free kill on the Shadow Fiend, and disengage. And that's always the important part, is that they're always able to cleanly disengage. They don't lose any heroes unnecessarily after that point. And OG are doing a really good job of still keeping up in the game. They're still distributing farm really well. It's just the looming threat of one Spectre gets a Radiance is always going to be on their minds. It's something that you almost always have to consider in this type of game.
And it's one thing getting farm and another thing turning that farm into something that you can actually utilize effectively. The SNY on Miracle Shadow Fiend, you know, tanks him up, gives him good fighting power early on, but are you looking for a BKB next? What do you aim for?
I'm not sure. It's kind of difficult right now because you're being dragged out of position. And something I really want to point out is every single time they go for the initiation with the Batrider, the Earth Spirit is lined up for the kick, so there's no sort of return. He's gotten it every single time. OG at some point just have to respect it. And QO.
With that DD rune, secures himself, Aegis of the Immortal. And about a grand away from that Radiance as well. Spectre, an absolute monster so far. Let's have a look at OG though. Crit, he's got his Arcane to Zern, he's got some sustainability, some team fight presence there. No Tail, who's actually going to be the one that heads into that Mantis style. It's good stats. Gets him that split, and there's nice illusions to help him push in. And Swindles was saying, Juggernaut, good hero against Spectre. What is it innately about Juggernaut that does so well against that Spectre?
Just your Omni Slash and your ability to keep up with the Healing Ward. You can kind of sustain past the initial ultimate. It's really hard to get caught out with Blade Fury as well, but in a game like this where the Spectre is getting relatively unchallenged, I think he's going to be pretty satisfied. And the crazy thing is that No Tail's still keeping up when it comes to farm, despite how many fights MVP has been able to win, and he's done a really, really good job. I don't want to underrate that whatsoever. It's just, again, I think, I can't remember who said it, but somebody said the game never really truly begins for Spectre until she gets her Radiance, and then you can kind of judge the situation of it after the first haunt.
And then you start bullying people like poor little Fly. 900 HP, he's gone for that little casual bracer to boost himself up. I'm taking a quick look at these scores, actually. Foreb, 0-1-12. He's died once this entire game, and this is something that he's very good at. You know, playing his Tidehunter, his Lone Druid, his Batriders. He knows when he can stick in lane, when he has to go back to base, but even in teamfights, keeping himself alive and knowing his limits is something that he's very, very apt at doing.
I think OG have to somehow start getting pickoffs, or probably wait for the Radiance. Or you probably have to wait until Miracle gets his BKB, which means that you sort of concede that there's going to be the Radiance already by the Spectre, but I think that's okay, because he's got the Aegis anyways, and that's not really what you want to fight into. But as soon as you get your core item on your Shadow Fiend, the next one, I think you immediately look for the fight. Try to start something, because every single time Frev's been initiating on him, with the Spec Haunt to come in, it causes way too much chaos for OG to follow through.
Well, Moon Meander skipping over the Blink Dagger, he's gone for the Hood of Defiance. Is this going to be the full pipe for him to help against the Bat Firefly?
Yeah, and I think it really just helps against the Spec Radiance too, which is now completed. And I think that's going to be MVP signal to fight, especially with when they have the Aegis up. Probably going to go for this Tier 1 because it is such a safe objective.
Because it's pretty damn good against that Earth Spirit as well, that Magnetize. All that magical damage being kicked across your entire team.
Yeah, I think he realizes it's more worth it than completing the Guardian Greaves first team. It's mainly magic damage. There's almost no physical damage on the side of MVP.
And then counter initiating with a blink into that Radiant Spectre, like you said, is close to impossible. Yeah. Especially if you want to go in for the instant counter initiation, having that period of time when the illusions are chasing you around. Really going to be what you're aiming for. And OG doing exactly what you're saying. Just group up, do not leave a man behind. Unless that man is Moon Meander, sprinting himself back to base.
He takes too long to kill, I think, for MVP. Your team is most likely able to respond in that time period, but MVP, they're going to say, we have the Aegis, we have pretty much the item set that we want to go for. Probably waiting for QO's next item is going to take a little bit too long, and MP, he's in a pretty good spot anyways.
We've seen the same move happen two or three times now in quick succession. The push into bottom tier 1 by OG, and then the swift EP's back to try and defend by MVP, but this time it was only Dubu that returned, the rest of them sticking around towards top, and maybe you can look to pick off the Dazzler. QO, he's still got the Aegis, but I don't think you want to go that deep in. The pings come through. Maybe OG can think about jumping straight onto the Spectre. There's a Lion Invoker behind him to try and save him. But it's such an annoying hero to kill, and kill twice, definitely.
Yeah, the good news for OG, though, is that MVP are not set up for this fight whatsoever. Dubu has had to push out that bottom lane, and Frev had to go back to his base. Right now, picks up the Yule Scepter for himself, and QO's about to lose that Aegis. He's getting really low right now.
Well, Vac back, QO. EMP will burn through Moon Meander, and he's dragged back into the finger again from Febby. Quick, snappy decision-making from MVP will get them a nice juicy kill on Moon Meander with a Tornado. Hang on a second. Catches Miracle, but...
They're trying to waste the Aegis.
Is it going to be quick enough, though? He's getting spun down. Yep, there we go. First life expended. And that's also Blade Fury on cooldown for a little while for No-Tail, but OG just hold the high ground. No reason to go wandering down into the pit of despair, which MVP call their own.
If you're MVP, you absolutely don't want Kyo to pop his ultimate when he's just at 300 HP. That's a really easy fight for OG to take at that point. The Haunt is what you want to fight around. MVP, they parlayed that into two-tier. They were able to take a tier 1 tower atop and get some pressure. And they're going to take this bottom one for free too, just because OG, again, they decided to maneuver around for mid. They don't have the best vision in their own jungle. So MVP are going to take full control of this right now.
Bad vision. Hang on a second. Kick across. Catches two and the jump in. QO. He's found Fly. They're going to take him out. There's no Dazzle here for you today. He's hexed up and killed off with Omnislash back on Odubu. He's the only target. But goes back onto QO. They'll look at No-Tail and say, juicy target. Thank you very much. The snowball will actually not be used to save him up. It's Crit running into the middle of three of them. But I think he sacrificed his life. Maybe. Not even for the greater good. As three of his team all drop like flies.
And I think this is going to be MVP signal to just keep going. They've got Frev with his ultimate available. This is a really good position for them to be in. They don't have buyback on any of the heroes that just died. And this is a pretty fantastic time for them to push. If they could get somebody with the bat too, a core hero. Frev's still looking for it.
The Yule Scepter up.
Oh, he's got him!
An illusion. He's actually called Miracle. They're dragging him back again with a kick. The stun, he's dead. There's no retreat from MVP.
Oh, that was sick. He forced Apson forward
into
so that he can
lasso.
Get in range.
Cheeky little devil. Well, they'll back themselves up. No need to overextend with a couple of heroes respawning. No one to be going into this vacuum wall or dealing with that Darkseer at all. I guess Roshan will find out when the big man returns in about 2 minutes.
I mean, that's fine for MVP. Like, they're just winning fight after fight after fight. And more importantly, they're not losing any of the core heroes. Like, that's the easiest thing. If you could pick off MP or if you could pick off QO in one of these engagements, even if you lose two heroes, a core plus one, you're okay with that because then you can start to build up some of that comeback gold and most importantly, the experience, especially for one of your supports. If you look at the difference in XP alone, getting any of the kills so far in MVP would be worth it for them. But MVP, every single time, it's quick engagement, get somebody, get out, then just play, wait for the Haunt game.
Well, guess what? It's going to be a bit of in and out here for everyone to crit. But the Tusk snowball in time, not sure where he's going to be heading. It's definitely not a warm retreat for him. A Tusk, he likes his cold, but Firefly burns him up. Moomiander TP's out. Looks like he's going to be okay. And QO just dealing with those illusions, battering away.
My favorite part about that too is that MVP, they didn't just stop moving around the map because Haunt was down. They knew that OG was going to be a little bit reluctant to take on head-on fights, so they just looked for the individual pickoff, but OG, they're doing the smart thing here. Now they're starting to try to split up a little bit more, take a little bit more risk just because they have to. They know that Miracle probably isn't going to die, even if they rotate like two heroes down, because they're just going to send stopgap heroes to deal with them anyways. Most likely the Spectre, and he can always BKB out of that one. As long as the Batrider isn't there. He does have his BKB now.
What's No-Tail going for? Is that Rub of the Magi going to be for a Diffusal Blade?
It might be.
I guess you can purge off the Earth Spirit's nasty spells. Forev, though, he's jumped in, blinks on the Fly again, they caught the Dazzle. And with the Spectral Haunt, maybe they'll look for people in the back end as well. Fly mechs up, but the Hex will mean he can't Grave and can't save. A Crit Moon. With the tier 3, I think they just have to give up this tower. There's no way they can defend.
And you can start to see MVP's game plan every single one of these fights. Don't let Fly get off Grave. Like, at all costs. They chain stun him really well in front of his team. They're going to pick up the tier 2. Good news for OG, though, is that they get a pretty decent trade in a game like this, where they are able to get the tier 1 and put some pressure at bottom. As Miracle is going to get gone on, but Frev, unfortunately, doesn't have Firefly.
Does he know that No-Tail is here?
Lasso.
He will, with the Yule Scepter and a Flying Vision, he sees him. But I think you're right, 80% of the time, Forev jumps straight onto the Dazzle, and if he can't see the Dazzle, he finds the Shadow Fiend and drags him back far enough.
Yeah, it's always one or two targets. He knows that the Shadow Fiend is priority if he can get away from Fly
Forev.
Far
enough. Oh, it's a bit tragic.
Oh, it's really good. Okay, that's the beginning. That's what they needed.
It's a big kill for the Shadow Fiend.
That's a gem, too. It was not an insignificant pickoff by any means.
The SF pick it up, he did. Took it back to Fountain. Shinies safe back in base. And MP Goisagan and Scepter. That's Invoker. He's stacking up and he's getting into these exit points as well. So we're going to start seeing the big old Meteor Deafening Blast as well on top of this EMP Tornado. But I think Kyo Spectre, now with the Manta Star done, if they do get a jump, if you know, the Earth Spike, the Hex, the Lasso, whatever it may be, onto the Dazzle, he just gets melted by the Spectre. Sunstrike scouts out Roshan, but OG, they're already in position here with the smoke, aggressively looking forward, maybe to catch someone off guard, because
oh, they know Kyo's in the pit right now.
They do. Dagger himself back up onto high ground, though, to safety with the rest of his team. High ground ward, Dubu. Oh, good stun, catches a two, and the snowball forward maybe puts Crit out of position, but the Earth Spike, one time off the mark, but with the damage they've got, I think it should be enough. Crit turns to try and fight for the turn rate. Tornado into the EMP, no death, deafening blast through the three. The Requiem wound up and takes a lot of damage down, but I don't know, OG, you're not in the best strategic position here, as QO is actually being right-clicked a fair amount by Miracle. The raid is burned, though, this missed chance as the BKB wears off, Ice Wall is out, and OG looks like they're gonna get fully wiped as a Miracle stuck in the icy hell.
What looked like it could have been an okay start if they could have been able to kill Dubu off the bat. Instead, just completely cuts him off from the rest of his team. That Ice Shard that he laid out ends up being his grave as OG get 5-0'd, and this is gonna be a Roshan for MVP, and it's not like their lineup gets worse over time.
Difficult proposition, and then you look at the rest of the map, right? It's not five guys going to Roshan, it's Febby blink dodging Ice Shards, you know, just because he can. Actually split pushing bottom lane, Forev was pushing mid. So it's not just, hey guys, we're doing Rosh and you're going to be annoyed by this. We're actually applying pressure on multiple lanes and forcing you to defend.
Yeah, you want to, when everybody's dead like that, just push out the lanes. Nobody can contest you. You get some map control out of it too. And it's not even like OG is inherently playing anything terribly wrong or anything like that. It's just they're getting outplayed in teamfights. It's very straightforward. Every single time they try to get the jump off, it's almost always MVP that's spread out as a group. It's almost like they just move as a unit. Everybody's just thinking under one hive mind. Then everybody's like, okay, I'm gonna run up this way, you start casting your spell down this way, I'll drag them forward to you. The line almost always gets three-man stuns as a result. Dubu almost always gets set up for his boulder smash.
How is Forev so fast? Oh, he's got a haste rune, he jumps onto Crit, catches him, and with a finger of death, I don't think snowballing out of this is gonna happen.
Yeah, and I think the reason why the Jug is gonna go, or was thinking about going for the Diffusal, is just because maybe if they have Ghost Scepters at some point on the supports, but Bebby said, no, I'm gonna go for Vanguard.
Crimson Guard, not bad.
It's okay. It's just kind of a... Bebby just has this weird obsession with, like, mid booster items.
Oh, does he? I mean, I guess, like, Darkseer Illusions, Omni Slash, Presence of the Dark Lord, that minus armor and all physical damage, Crimson Guard can give you a little bit of leeway there if you think you're gonna get caught out.
But... as Febby's ex-teammate, he just likes to do stuff.
So there's little reasoning behind it. It's just like, I like Vanguard.
He's like, that's a cool item. I swear.
That shield has a face on it. I think he'll buy one.
Yeah, Frev is 8 seconds are gonna wait for this. The Haunt is available for the Spectre, and this is the combination they've gone to time and time again. If OG is gonna have any help, this is the fight. They're gonna have to hold.
What's their initiation plan, though? So as soon as they make one step forward, it's gonna be the Spectral Haunt, the Blink Lasso. Forev's Firefly's gone for 20 seconds, though. Not necessarily needed, as they do have the damage output behind them. And also, with the Alacrity onto Spectre, is just ripping apart this melee barracks. Down to 2/3 HP, and there's a glyph here for OG, but they're waiting and biding their time with the EMP forward. They've actually caught Miracle. He doesn't use his BKB in time, and has got no mana left. The Sunstrike through, and Miracle pushed up into the high ground somehow, but Febby, there's the Hex, here's the damage, and Miracle with no buyback left. MVP, they're running rampant through the OG base. A good vacuum back into the wall as well, but MVP sustained through it all, and OG one after the other. Omni Slash onto MP, cancelled out by the Yules, and I think No Tail. GG is called. MVP take game number one up against OG.
And the crowd is very appreciative because this was clean Dota. And this was so well done by MVP. The amount of fights where they just had 5 clean kills, no deaths. They worked around each other as a group really well. The laning phase even looked like it went pretty well for OG for the first 4 or 5 minutes as the supports were able to rotate down. But MVP, they had a game plan going into every fight. Take out the 2 saving heroes. Make sure we slow down Miracle's progress.
Testament to OG, the scoreline was 8-37, but they made it feel like they still had a way in. But we'll go back to the panel. Cap and the lads, take it away.